Hi there, and welcome to Central Texas Gardener. I'm Tom Spencer. Thanks to climatic warning, there are plants we can grow now that I didn't dare try when I started gardening. Then we get a few winters to humble us again. Today, William Scheick shares his insight on the perils and pleasures of zone pushing. On tour, let's visit a creative gardener who likes that challenge.
When master gardener Randy Case updated his 1950s home, he gave it a new look outside, too.
I bought the house in September of 2004, and I was looking for a small house with a big yard. That's what I, because I love gardening. And it was just a huge St. Augustine expanse. That's all it was. I mean, it had a few trees, large trees, one in the front, one in the back, actually. And other than that, there was nothing, just some really healthy grass.
Randy focused on the front yard and its slope once he tackled updates inside.
A friend had given me a bunch of stones. He had some extra from a wall that he had built. And I had them stacked around. I moved them all over the place, and they weigh a ton. I moved them everywhere. And finally, one day, I just thought, I think I'll just cut this back and build a wall here. And that's why I did it.
Above the wall, anchoring tall plants frame a cove near the house. On the other side, he renovated a spot that was challenged by borders of reflected heat. Randy wanted privacy for the front window, but questioned how to handle the narrow space.
I just had this idea one day to build those boxes. And I couldn't figure out a design, and then I saw a photo of the Guggenheim Museum with the way it's small at the bottom and it goes up. And I wish I could have made them round like that or fluid lines, but you know, that was what prompted me to do that.
He didn't neglect the driveway and side yard either, partly because his list of plants to try was getting longer by the minute.
I like the idea too of when you see a house that has a lot of greenery in the front yard, and all you can really see usually is maybe the roof or the front door. To me, that gives it mystery, you know. Like, I look at that house and I think, what's back there? You know, I just want to know. And so that's another thing that I'm going for. I just like that idea.
It wasn't until 2009 that he got serious about the backyard.
You know, I had some ideas, but that's another thing. I'm a real perfectionist. And I can look at someone else's yard and tell them exactly what to do. You know, it's just, I see it and I'm like, okay, this should be this way and this should be this way. But in my own yard, I was just, for several months, I was just frozen because I wanted it to be perfect. And I had a heck of a time figuring it out, really. But I finally, I would write stuff down, and I was writing down I wanted a really large patio that went the entire length of the house. And I just had these ideas, and then one day it just sort of gelled, and I got the metal edging and laid it all out. I put it all together and laid it out several different times and tried different shapes, you know, until I came up with one that I really liked. And then it really just kind of evolved on its own. I started with the patio. That was the first thing I did. And then from there, it just all sort of came together, you know. It just sort of one thing after another, and eventually it all kind of fell into place. My goal on all of that really was to get rid of the St. Augustine grass. It was kind of a shame. I mean, I moved in here and the grass, it was really pretty and healthy, you know. But I would look at it and think, I don't want this. You know, I don't want grass. It's waste so much water.
For now, he's kept some grass, but management techniques keep it content on limited water. In its restricted use, the lawn contributes to the other textural diversity Randy uses to define spaces and show off his plants. He also defines spaces by pairing and layering plants, avoiding strict homogeneous rows.
I'm colorblind, and so really bold colors and textures, you know, is what I can see more clearly, so I don't really usually go for subtle.
Every thought of you makes my heart sing like an April breeze on the wings of spring.
You know, they tell you in gardening that you don't want to get too many different varieties because it'll look messy and junky, and I think if you want them, do it. You know, it's your yard and you should just do what you want. I mean, there are the rules, and I think the rules are there for a reason and that there's a lot of wisdom behind those rules. But I also think that you can bend the rules or break them, you know, for your own, to suit your own tastes. And I do that a lot.
With pots and salvage finds, Randy adds further dimension, definition, and discovery. As much as he loves collecting old furniture and props, at first he wasn't sure what to do with one must-have from Craigslist.
One day I just leaned it against the fence over there, and I noticed that when I leaned it against the fence, that it looked like it opened up into the next yard. The trunk of my tree matched up with the top of the tree on the other side of the fence in several points in the yard. And so I just thought that was so neat, so I just went ahead and put it up there. It also brings a little light. That was a dark area because it's a shady spot. And when I put the mirror in, it brightened it up quite a bit.
As a gardener on an adventure that never ends, Randy really only has two rules.
I guess my philosophy on gardening is that in this climate, anything that wants to thrive in this climate has a place in my yard. I mean, you know, there's some things, I don't really baby anything. I'll plant it and try it, and if it does well, then it can stay, and I'll plant more of them if it really thrives. But if it dies, then I just, you know, next thing. You know, there's plenty of things to choose from here. And I think that, you know, you need to put your personal touch on your yard and do what makes you happy.
Now, talk about your garden makeovers. Thanks, Randy, for sharing that one with us. Absolutely terrific job. Right now, we're going to be talking about something that may be a new concept to some of you, but for us veteran gardeners here in Austin, it's something we're used to thinking about. That's the joys and perils of zone pushing. I'm joined by Bill Scheick. Bill, you're a retired professor of English, but a really passionate gardener. How did you get interested in gardening? I've got to ask that question before we get underway.
It's a bit of a mystery to me too. But I do remember when I was a child, we would spend part of the summer at a shore in New Jersey.
Mm-hmm.
And as a child who grew up in Newark, New Jersey, I did not have
not much exactly the most verdant place on earth.
Not really. And I was amazed by the amount of flora that mm-hmm. existed on that coast. And I actually one time transplanted some wild tiger lilies onto a property. And I think maybe from that time on, I was fascinated by having some interaction okay. with growing things.
You may have pushed a zone there, too. Now, we're talking about this concept of zone pushing. This is something that, for a lot of people out there, they think, what does that mean? We're talking about plant zones here, right?
And we're specifically talking about cold hardiness zones, because
okay.
there are also heat zones,
okay.
which many people don't know about.
Okay.
But cold hardiness zones have to do with the limits of what a plant can take by way of mm-hmm. freezing temperatures or cold.
Right.
What zone are we? Mm-hmm. Officially, according to the USDA, the Department of Agriculture, we are Zone 8 in Central Texas.
Mm-hmm.
But if you look around and you see what people are growing, you'll notice that they're in the ground.
Mm-hmm.
You'll notice that they are growing Zone 9 plants routinely
mm-hmm.
and even Zone 10 plants.
Mm-hmm. And this is something that anybody who has gardened for a while in Austin really notices, is that there are a lot of plants that we can, quote, get away with now
right.
that we couldn't back in, say, like the 1980s.
Right. And there's a joy in being able to expand the
right.
repertoire of your mm-hmm. garden by including plants that you might associate more with San Antonio or farther south.
Mm-hmm.
The risk, of course, can be if you're not careful, or if the plants aren't established. And I think that's the key word,
right.
established. established zone 9 plants do very well here.
Mm-hmm.
But the risk is can be those 3 days in the 18 degrees that we had last winter.
Right.
There are ways of minimizing that risk.
Mm-hmm.
One is to position your plant for microclimates that are advantageous for them, south sides of structures.
Exactly.
Along foundations which retain heat even in mm-hmm. winter mm-hmm. from the sun. Adequate mulching, pine bark
right.
would be best. And something that people don't think about much, but throwing a bucket of water on the roots, at least not less than 24 hours before
yeah.
a freeze, but between 48 and 24 hours.
And I think that is something that a lot of people forget, is that a plant that is adequately, has enough moisture,
right.
it was much more able to sustain a heavy frost damage than one that's dry.
Right.
And for some people, that seems counterintuitive. They think that putting water out in advance of a cold front could imperil the plant in some way. But just the opposite seems to be the case.
Right. I noticed, too, that when we have frost mm-hmm. or freezing, if you look at your property, because we have such a light frost or snowfall mm-hmm. level, mm-hmm. you'll notice there are places where there's no accumulation.
Mm-hmm.
That's a microzone,
mm-hmm.
A climate zone, rather, to be right. exploited
right.
for pushing the zone of a plant.
Okay. So
often over plumbing, over mm. waste water lines.
Okay.
You'll notice there's no
sure.
no frost over that.
Yeah. Well, underneath of trees, up against buildings, all these little
right.
different things that offer advantages. You know, there could be different zones in your own yard, effectively,
right.
if you really are attuned to that. And a lot of gardeners, over time, become that attuned to their garden. They know where these different spots are, the moister spots,
correct.
The drier spots, the hotter and colder spots. So this is a fascinating topic. Now, how can people know where we are now? This is one thing that is a little confusing, because there are competing maps out there.
There are. The USDA map is over 20 years old, and apparently, I mean, from our anecdotal experience, not satisfactory.
Mm-hmm.
The National Arbor Day Foundation, on their website, has a more updated cold hardiness zone map.
Mm-hmm.
And it was released in 2006, I believe. And that map shows Central Austin to be Zone 9, in fact,
mm-hmm.
which means if we're planting Zone 9 plants, we might not really be pushing.
Right.
Which is why some people actually have gone to zone 10 plants here. I've seen
always pushing the edge.
it's a gamble.
Right.
Where the house of nature holds the odds, but
right.
you can hedge those odds by being very sensitive about where you and how you take care
right.
of your plants.
Well, I want to give people an idea about some of the different plants, because you talk about the joys of this, and there are a lot of plants out there that really do bring joy to gardeners. And there's some of these that that you've had success with, or you've at least experimented with.
Right.
There's an Echinopsis species here that called Big Bertha, and this is one that, again, I would look at this plant and I would say, no way would I grow this in the ground.
No, and I don't blame you. Actually, when I had a writing assignment from the Austin paper, it's one of those great writing assignments. Go to 5 nurseries, find the hottest plant at each nursery and feature it.
Mm-hmm.
And I found Big Bertha at the Natural Gardener.
Mm-hmm.
But I had to weigh what to recommend to someone who would buy this pricey plant with pie-sized flowers on it.
Mm-hmm.
And I did write and say, I think you better put it in the container. Well, I heard from a reader saying, I'm growing them in the ground.
Mm-hmm.
This is a zone 10 plant.
Right.
This particularly a hybrid, and it might be because it's a hybrid, it's doing better in the ground here.
Mm-hmm.
It's still going to be risky to
yeah.
some extent.
Right.
I had very good success with a plant from China. It's a zone 9 plant called pink jasmine,
mm-hmm.
Jasminum polyanthem.
Mm-hmm.
For years and years I've had it, and with very little care, it ran its vine around things. But this last winter, I mean, even after all those years of success, it's clearly been set back. I have about 7 of those plants, they've all been set back. Mm-hmm. Now, I wasn't neglectful with them. Mm-hmm. And maybe if I had been more attentive, I got the trust after a while that they were going to run.
False trust.
I know.
Which is one of the perils.
They're not dead, but it's going to take time for them to come back.
Right, right. And so often the recovery time is slow. Now, a lot of people are growing plumerias in the ground here. This is just, when I started in the nursery trade, this would have been unthinkable.
It is. Still almost unthinkable. Mm-hmm. But I've noticed that people who are doing that have them definitely located mm-hmm. in strategic places where north wind and exposure, mm-hmm. excess exposure won't overtest them. Mm-hmm. Still, in the long run, I'm not sure how that experiment will turn out.
Really? Well, we'll see. You know, there are a lot of different kufias as well, and this is a plant that has become very popular. The bat-faced kufia, for example, is one that I see lots of people planting in the ground now.
Actually, and it's treated as a xeriscape plant. Mm-hmm. One benefit of all the kufias is that they have small taproots, which means they do need water to keep flowering, but they don't need much water to mm-hmm. keep flowering. The downside is that they are small, and if you don't mulch them, you do run a risk of losing them. They're zone 9 plants, mm-hmm. all of them, including Mexican heather, which is a very beautiful, compact, marginal plant, to the cigar or firecracker kufea,
right.
which is a somewhat larger but easily managed, to the bat-faced, which can get quite wide, mm-hmm. Can get 3-4 feet wide,
right?
Which is and also a beautiful plant.
An incredible flower. Now, we only have just a few seconds left here, Bill, but I want to let people know that they can follow you in a lot of different sources. You write for the Austin American Statesman.
Have written for them.
Also Texas Gardener magazine.
I'm a contributing editor.
Right. So they can find your articles there and share some of those perils and joys with you as you continue your explorations in the garden, like so many of the rest of us are. So thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you for having me.
All right, and coming up next is Daphne Richards.
Hello and welcome to Down to Earth. I'm Daphne Richards. Our question this week is from Nancy, who wants to know what to do with her tomatoes when hot weather comes very early in the spring or is sporadic. She's already had several 90-degree days in her area. And yes, by mid-April, Nancy, and even earlier most years, it is already hot in Central Texas. Though tomatoes do love the heat, it can be too intense for them here. When we have hot weather early in the planting season, you definitely need to be careful watering those plants. And when we have hot weather during the flowering season, fruiting will be affected. Hot temperatures and dry air will denature the pollen on those flowers, making it infertile. So what you want to be careful about is watering those plants properly early in the season. So good quality small aggregate mulch around those plants will increase the humidity in the air around them, helping to keep the pollen nice and moist so that it will be active. You may also use a little bit of light shade cloth to decrease the intensity of the sun, but be careful not to use too heavy of a grade on that so you don't screen out too much of the sun. These plants do need a full day of sun to flower and fruit for you. Also, regular irrigation is important to combat blossom end rot and fruit cracking. Blossom end rot is caused by calcium deficiency, but that calcium deficiency is caused by irregular watering. Watering too little and then too much, and letting the soil dry out and stay too wet in between your waterings. Our plant this week is native prairie verbena, Glandularia bipinnativida. It's another one of our beautiful native wildflowers that may be seen along roadsides and in fields if it's not overshadowed by those taller wildflowers in nature. It has beautiful light purple round clusters of flowers on short stalks. And like most of our native wildflowers, prairie verbena does well in shallow, rocky, disturbed soils. It can grow great in full sun, but it can also tolerate shade. It just might have fewer flowers in that situation. It spreads easily, making it a great ground cover choice, or use it to fill in near rocky paths and borders. It has blue-green, velvety-looking foliage with highly divided leaves, and it'll do fine on natural rainfall. It'll perform a little bit better if you irrigate it just a bit, but don't overwater it. stays around 6 inches tall and spreads easily to 18 inches wide and much wider if given space. It's a perennial, so it dies back to the ground and returns from the roots each year. It looks great planted in large open areas and left unmowed. Although it's easy to miss when you plant it in wildflower seed mixes with other taller wildflowers. It's listed as hardy to 28 degrees, so these would not have trouble reemerging after a cold winter. To do this week in your garden, it's time to prune any spring flowering trees, shrubs, or vining roses, if those flowers are spent and you need to keep that plant in bounds. This does not apply to your fruit trees, but you do need to thin out the fruit for better harvest. So once those flowers are spent, be watching for the fruit so you can prune them out and have larger fruit but fewer. We'd love to hear from you. Please visit klru.org/ctg to send us your question or a plant of the week from your garden.
Thanks, Daphne. Now let's check in with Trisha Shirey for Backyard Basics.
The next time you see that you have garden pests, you might want to wait to grab those chemicals. There are some things that you can do to get rid of insects and keep beneficials on the job. Now, the first thing you want to know is, are there beneficials out there after the bugs on your plants? Many times people don't realize that beneficial insects look very different, and even the pest insects will look different at different stages of their life. So you want to know all the various stages of pest insects and beneficials so that you can get rid of the ones that you really want to. Now, hand picking is one of the easy ways to do pest control, but temperature is very important. Insects will move more quickly as the temperatures increase, so it's a lot easier to hand pick bugs off early in the morning when it's still cool. You can actually wet the plants down with a strong water spray, and that will cool the bugs down too and makes them easier to control. I actually have a pitcher that I put soapy water in and just tap the plants and tap the bugs, the pests, right into that soapy water and get rid of bugs that way. Also, just blasting the plants with a strong water spray is a good first alternative for controlling aphids or spider mites and many other pests. You don't want to harm the leaves, but make sure you really spray the underside of the leaves to get all of the bugs off. Now, you can also use your vacuum cleaner in the garden, a dust buster with a crevice type tool on the end, or if your dust buster doesn't have a crevice tool, you might be able to put a black plastic pipe, a flexible pipe in that's used for irrigation to make more of a homemade crevice tool. But I have a shop vac that has a battery pack, and I go out with a crevice tool, and I'm able to vacuum up the stink bug, nymphs, and harlequin beetles, and some of the slower moving pests. And with the crevice tool, I can skip over ladybugs and other beneficial insects and not vacuum those up. Now, you can also put cutworm collars on plants. This is very easy to do with aluminum foil. And I roll the foil up on a diagonal so it's a little bit wider in the middle. And then I take the ends and twist them together. And heavy-duty foil will be able to be recycled from year to year. But I put one of these around every tomato, eggplant, pepper, to foil those cutworms that will just slice your plants off. If you've ever gone out and seen your plants just looking like someone took a scissors and snipped them off at the soil line, that was the work of the cutworm, and this foil collar will take care of that quite easily. Now, grapefruits and plant saucers or boards can make traps out in the garden. Just put a grapefruit half down, or a clay plant saucer really works best. Put it upside down, and that becomes a trap for pill bugs and snails and slugs. They'll go up under that moist area and congregate, and then you can scoop them up easily and drown them in some soapy water. You can also use tuna cans or cat food cans for pill bugs and snails and slugs with a little bit of beer in them. Now, you want to bury that down in the soil so that the soil level is right up to the top of the can, and that way the bugs will climb in and drown and get rid of some of that the pests in your garden. You can also plant trap crops for various bugs. If you're having problems with potato beetles, putting an eggplant or two around your potatoes will help, because the potato beetles love eggplant more than they do the potatoes, and so they'll demolish those plants, and then I just usually pull those plants out and get rid of them, and the potatoes are nice and safe. Parsley worms, are beautiful butterflies, but the larva of the swallowtail butterflies, and they really go after parsley and dill and eat them up. So I just move those worms to my fennel, and the fennel can handle all of that damage, and I still get my parsley to eat. Cardoon and sunflowers and artichokes are great trap crops for stink bugs. The stink bugs love to lay their eggs on it, and the larvae congregate there, which makes them really easy to vacuum off and get rid of. So I make sure I plant those so that I save my tomatoes and peppers from the stink bugs. So there are ways to control insects without using chemicals. For Backyard Basics, I'm Trisha Shari. See you next week.
Visit klru.org/ctg to watch online, get more tips, and read our blog. Next week, we preview the Wildflower Center's Gardens on Tour. Until then, I'll see you in the garden.